Chantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blue Rage, Black Redemption, a Memoir by Stanley Tookie Williams. Foreword by Tavis Smiley. Epilogue by Barbara Becknell. Narrated by Ferlon Webster Jr. President Nixon emphasizes that you have to face the fact that the whole problem is really the blacks. The key is to devise a system that recognizes this while not appearing to. H.R. Haldeman, The Haldeman Diaries, Inside the Nixon White House. Foreword. It started out as a gray Friday morning, and as I rushed into a West Oakland McDonald's to grab a breakfast sandwich, I heard the commotion coming from a table of older black gentlemen in the back of the restaurant. "If he killed those people, he ought to die," said one. "Well, whether he did it or not, if he stays locked up for the rest of his life, that ain't living," said another. "He might as well be dead." Although I tried to avoid this breakfast table debate, as soon as I was spotted, I was summoned to the table. "Tavis Smiley, what are you doing here?" one brother yelled out. "We're talking about that gang leader Tookie Williams who was supposed to be executed for killing those people in L.A. back in the day." "So Smiley," asked another, "what do you think? Should he die?" The whole scene was surreal. I had just flown to Oakland International Airport that morning, and ironically, my radio producer and I were on our way to San Quentin to meet with Stanley Tookie Williams. He asked to meet me in person before doing an interview that would be aired on both my radio and television shows. It was November 25th, 2005, the day after Thanksgiving, and I was already riding a sea of emotions long before being confronted by the Breakfast Club. Of all the McDonald's we could have chosen. The truth is, at that moment, I wasn't sure how to respond to the brother's question. All I knew for sure is that I am vehemently opposed to the death penalty, and as a person of faith, I believe in the scripture where God says, "Vengeance is mine." So, without going into too much more detail, that was my answer as I wished the brothers a good day. As I got back in the car, I started thinking about the morning ahead. Although unfortunately I visited friends or family members in jail over the years, fortunately I had never been to death row. I wasn't sure what to expect, but as for Stanley, I had a little bit of insight. When Jamie Foxx came on my television show, he talked about what it was like to portray Stanley in the television movie Redemption, The Stan Tookie Williams Story. Jamie also told me that in spite of Stanley's imposing figure, a massive chest and bulging arms and legs from bodybuilding, Stanley was very gentle and soft-spoken. When we arrived at San Quentin a short while later, I found all of that to be true. After going through two metal detectors and security doors, we waited in a small visitor cell that held an old table, a few chairs, and a small barred window that looked out onto the bay. A few minutes later, a guard escorted the shackled, gentle, soft-spoken bodybuilder with glasses and gray hair to the cell. After his cuffs were unlocked, he reached out, shook my hand, and said, "I'm Stan, and I've been waiting to meet you." As we sat down, Stan immediately opened the window, and we began to talk. We talked briefly about the childhood he discusses at length in this book. We talked about what it was like to be in prison for nearly 25 years, what an average day was like, and how he had coped for all that time. We talked about his children's books and his Nobel Peace Prize nomination. Then I asked some of the tough questions. I asked him about his life as a gang leader and how he felt about all the death and destruction caused in the black community by gang violence in Los Angeles, where I live, as well as many other parts of the country. I asked him about the murders for which he was convicted and how he felt about the victims' families. I also asked him about the fact that he reportedly refused to assist law enforcement with information in their efforts to arrest, prosecute, and convict other gang members. Stan solemnly and candidly answered all my questions. He told me that he was sorry for his gang involvement and for the havoc he had personally wreaked in the community. He said that he was sorry for the losses suffered by the Owens and Yang families, but maintained that he was innocent of the murders. He told me that he believes God allowed him to go to prison to pay for some of the horrible things he had done in his life, although ultimately he was being punished for crimes he did not commit. Regarding his cooperation with law enforcement, Stan gave me a somewhat more complicated explanation. He said that it was a violation of a prison code for him to discuss certain gang-related matters because of broader implications that could lead to more violence for him and other prison members. Then we talked about the power of redemption. Stan told me that prison had afforded him the time to read and learn and grow. He shared how through prayer, reflection, and discipline, he had changed from a young, violent man filled with rage to a man whose life revealed redemption. Throughout our conversation, Stan held my gaze and his calm never wavered. And then we talked about his impending death. He told me that he had already told the prison that he had chosen to deny his last meal, and with the exception of Minister Louis Farrakhan, he would deny last rites or counsel with any clergy. I told him about the brothers at McDonald's and the questions that I had been asked. In particular, I wanted to know how he felt about fighting to spend the rest of his life, which could be another 25 plus years, behind bars. Death or life in prison? What does it feel like to face that inevitability? Stan smiled as he told me that his ability to influence young people to stay out of gangs was reason enough to want to live. He said that in spite of the soul-stripping regimens of prison, he had learned how to create and experience his own joie de vivre, the French term for joy of life. As our conversation ended, we stood, shook hands, and as I patted him on the back in a brief embrace, he reminded me to keep the faith. I realized that this could be the first and last time I would see him. It was. 3 weeks later, Stan was executed by lethal injection by the state of California. The night before he died, I couldn't sleep. I stayed awake past midnight, and after he was pronounced dead, I felt numb. Even after such a brief encounter, I felt a connection to another black man whose life, through bad circumstances and bad choices, like so many others, had ended way too soon. I also felt sorrow for all the mothers and fathers and communities that have lost loved ones to gang violence. After wrestling with these thoughts, I realized that Stan's legacy can be one of tragedy and triumph. It is also a legacy that helped me grapple with the power of redemption. I believe that Stan reminded our society that we send people to prison to rehabilitate them, and we have to believe that process is real and possible for even some of the worst offenders. Ultimately, if we don't believe in redemption, we don't believe in America. For many reasons, meeting Stan was a life-changing experience that reminded me that but for the earnest prayers of my mother and the grace of God, as a black man, I too could have been one of the four black men in prison, on probation, or on parole. I was blessed to have that personal encounter with Stan, but for all of those who will never be able to witness his courage, conviction, and commitment to prevent young people from taking the same path he did, you can experience some of that pain and passion throughout this book, Blue Rage, Black Redemption. I sincerely hope that for many young men and women in Los Angeles and throughout the country, Stan's death will reaffirm the importance of life. Tavis Smiley, Los Angeles, 2007. Introduction. The title of this book represents two extreme phases of my life. Blue Rage is a chronicle of my passage down a spiraling path of Crip rage in South Central Los Angeles. Black Redemption depicts the stages of my redemptive awakening during my more than 23 years of imprisonment on California's death row. These memoirs of my evolution will, I hope, connect the listener to a deeper awareness of a social epidemic that is the unending nightmare of racial minorities in America and abroad as well. Throughout my life, I was hoodwinked by South Central's terminal conditions, its broad and deadly template for failure. From the beginning, I was spoon-fed negative stereotypes that covertly positioned black people as genetic criminals, inferior, illiterate, shiftless, promiscuous, and ultimately, three-fifths of a human being, as stated in the Constitution of the United States. Having bought into this myth, I was shackled to the lowest socioeconomic rung where underprivileged citizens compete ruthlessly for morsels of the American pie, a pie theoretically served proportionally to all, based on their ambition, intelligence, and perseverance. Like many others, I became a slave to a delusional dream of capitalism's false hope, a slave to diseducation, a slave to nihilism, a slave to drugs, a slave to black-on-black violence, and a slave to self-hate. Paralyzed within a social vacuum, I gravitated toward thughood, not out of aspiration, but out of desperation, to survive the monstrous inequities that show no mercy to young or old. Aggression, I was to learn, served as a poor man's merit for manhood. To die as a street martyr was seen as a noble thing. In 1971, I met Raymond Lee Washington, may he rest in peace, and we ultimately decided to unite our homeboys from the west and east sides of South Central to combat neighboring street gangs. An erroneous grapevine suggests that the Crips formed in 1969, or even as early as the 1950s. Most Crips themselves are unaware that the original name for our alliance was Cribs, a name selected from a list of many options. But the short-lived label of Cribs was carelessly mispronounced by many of us and morphed into the name Crips, our permanent identity. Most of us were 17 years of age. The Crips mythology has many romanticized, bogus accounts. I never thought it would be necessary to address such issues, but I can set the record straight. For Raymond Washington, for me, and for others who fought and often died for this causeless cause. I assume that everyone in South Central knew that Raymond was the leader of the East Side Crips and that I was the leader of the West Side Crips. A few published chronicles have Raymond attending Washington High School and uniting the neighborhood West Side gangs where he supposedly resided. In fact, Raymond attended Fremont High School on the East Side where he lived. A fundamental inquiry would have revealed that I lived on the West Side, where I attended Washington High, and rallied our homeboys and groups of local gangs. Even our former rivals have a better understanding of the Crips' origins than many social historians. Most of the public misinformation has been fostered by academics, journalists, and other parasitical opportunists, stool pigeons, and wannabe Crip founders who shamelessly seek undue profit and recognition for gang genocide. There is no honor in insinuating yourself as a player in this legacy of bloodletting where your feet have never trod. Another version incorrectly documents the Crips as an offshoot of the Black Panther Party. No Panther Party member ever mentioned the Crips, or Cribs, as being a spinoff of the Panthers. It is also fiction that the Crips functioned under the acronym CRIP, for Community Resource Inner City Project, or Community Revolutionary Inner City Project. Words such as revolutionary agenda were alien to our thuggish, uninformed teenage consciousness. We did not unite to protect the community. Our motive was to protect ourselves and our families. There are people who say it was karmic justice that Raymond and I, who impinged on society in 1971 with a violent pact, deserved our exit from society in 1979. Raymond to the grave, and myself to San Quentin State Prison. They cry out that I am incapable of redemption. My detractors' attitude toward my redemption is driven largely by my open apology to Black folks and others whom I have offended by my helping to create the Crips over 33 years ago. My detractors argue that I could not be redeemed because I have not apologized to the family members of the victims I was convicted of killing. Please allow me to clarify. I will never apologize for capital crimes that I did not commit. Not even to save my life. And I did not commit the crimes for which I was sentenced to be executed by the state of California. Being a condemned prisoner, I am viewed among the least able to qualify as a promoter of redemption and of peace. But the most wretched among society can be redeemed, find peace, and reach out to others to lift them up. Real redemption cannot be faked or intellectualized. It must be subjective, experienced, and then shared. In the past, redemption was an alien concept to me, but from 1988 until 1994, while I lived in solitary confinement, I embarked on a transitional path toward redemption. I underwent years of education, soul-searching, edification, spiritual cultivation, and fighting to transcend my inner demons. Subsequently, the redeeming process for me symbolized the end of a bad beginning and a new start. In time, I developed a conscience that empowered me to think beyond the selfish I principle. Armed with new insight, I discovered the means to control my ego, which enabled me to reunite with God, to reclaim my humanity, to discover inner peace, and to find my raison d'etre, my reason to be. Since then, I have written 9 anti-gang and anti-violence books for children, created the Internet Project for Street Peace, an international peer mentoring program that links high-risk youth in other countries to their counterparts in the United States, and wrote a local street peace protocol that provides guidance on how to initiate a gang truce and is available to anyone who chooses to download it from my website at tookie.com. Yes, redemption has resurrected me from a spiritual and mental death, and whether people are able to accept my redemption or not, they can never take it away. God chooses to redeem, not the laws of the government, the media, the sanctimonious, or the vindictive. To be redeemed, I have learned, is to be at peace with oneself. In fact, true virtue is self-victory by a path of redemption to peace. To avoid damaging others, certain names, nicknames, and quite a few well-known incidents have been excluded from Blue Rage Black Redemption. For the same reason, I have used pseudonyms for some of the people I include in this book. Otherwise, the story I tell is true. Part 1. Blue Rage. Chapter 1. Born in the Bayou. On December 29, 1953, in New Orleans Charity Hospital, I entered the world kicking and screaming in a cesarean ritual of blood and scalpels. Because this was the 1950s in pre-Civil Rights Louisiana, my 17-year-old mother, a colored woman, was deprived of anesthetics as her torso was slit from sternum to pubic bone. Over and over again, she sang the Christmas carol, Silent Night, to distract her from the pain. I was christened Stanley Tookie Williams III, but mostly referred to as Tookie. Perhaps my laborious birth and a seizure I experienced before the age of 2, requiring a spinal tap, foreshadowed more tragic things to come. But I've always felt that the real adversity fell on my teenage mother because of her station in life, a black woman living in the South and with very little money. Morbid conditions of poverty were eager to devour us. Being exposed to this apocalyptic society, as I grew to adolescence, my thin skin of innocence began to peel slowly away. In my life, the natural progression from maternal weaning to paternal guidance was absent. My father was the weak link in the family equation. He had abandoned us before I reached my first birthday. My memories of him were so remote that I could not have recognized him in a jailhouse lineup. He was like a stranger showing up once in a blue moon, bearing gifts and an uncertain smile. His attempts at playing part-time Santa Claus and spreading good cheer failed to win me over. As far as I was concerned, my father was an unwelcome visitor whom I watched carefully until he vacated the premises. My mother was the true backbone of the family. She was hardworking, serious, tough, and soft-spoken, and had the foot speed of a cheetah. I can attest to that quickness through my many failed attempts to escape punishment. Prior to my mother's pregnancy, she was well known as a track star. Her genes were passed down to me. I could outrun my peers and many older youths. Standing at 5'2", she was a vision of loveliness with chocolate-hued skin, a shapely physique, and long, silky black hair. But my mother's beauty attracted a lot of unwanted male attention. Though her no-nonsense expression held most men at bay, a few boldly approached. Their foolhardy advances compelled me, for a while, to carry a sharpened 7-inch butter knife concealed in my waistband. To protect my mother, I would have happily become a ninja mercenary. Unknown to my mother, I later stashed that knife beneath a slab of rock in the backyard. Had she discovered it, I would have been severely beaten, or disciplined, as she called it. My mother adhered religiously to the Judeo-Christian Bible, in particular, Proverbs chapter 13, verse 24. He who spareth his rod hateth his son, but he that loveth him chastiseth him betimes, whips him quickly. Yes, my mother loved me deeply, and I regularly felt her left sting. But compared to the beating some of my friends received from their parents, I got off easy. I will admit, the biblically inspired beatings did make me tougher. On the other hand, her punishments failed to derail my misbehavior. The frequency of beatings aged me considerably. I became more unruly, distant, and indifferent to the predictable consequence of my actions. By no means was I born a criminal. I understood the penalties for my actions all too well. Though my mother tried to instill in me the fundamentals of right and wrong, the development of my conscience was shaded with different meanings. I learned from the street culture that criminal activity was an economic necessity and violence a means to a desired end. Plain and simple, in my neighborhood, if you wanted something, you had to take it, and then fight to keep it. I clashed often with my mother over my mindset and incorrigible behavior. Whatever was physically possible for a mischievous youth my size to do, I did. Motivated by greed and envy, I took to stealing little food items and toys from stores. If my mother happened to discover any item unaccounted for, she would march me back to return the item, or would destroy it. Although I didn't completely understand this, my philosophy was hardening: adapt and survive. That was the street rule. Sometimes my partner in crime was Rex, my brown and white mutt dog. The entire neighborhood was in an uproar over my letting Rex run through the flower beds and chase chickens and roosters. Time and time again, I was warned about unleashing Rex, but it was all fun and games to me. Eventually, I had to watch teary-eyed as Rex was hauled away to the dog pound. If there was a lesson to be learned, I didn't grasp it. Being mischievous, hyperactive, and with a short attention span, I had to find something to do. My older cousin Walter and I used to slide and tumble on a gunny sack down a nearby dirt hill. Too poor to afford baseball equipment, we liked playing stickball with rocks and would play stickball for hours before dinner. That was stopped after Walter hit a rock that smashed into my forehead. Blood gushed everywhere. My grandmother, Mama, simply patched me up with some beech nut chewing tobacco, a trusted home remedy, and I was good as new. But my stickball days were over. I believe it was the lingering racist effects of Jim Crow, systematic discrimination against Southern blacks during the period following the Civil War, as well as my incorrigible behavior that fueled my mother's desire to migrate to California. She first planned to leave me behind and then send for me after she got settled, but I was too hyperactive for my aunts and my aging grandmother. If you recall the Beverly Hillbillies and the woman called Granny, you will have a pretty good notion about Mama's stature and style of dress. A beautiful Cherokee Indian, she was 5 feet tall, about 90 pounds, with whitish-gray shoulder-length hair and a copper penny skin tone. She was a devout Baptist who had served as a deaconess for 17 years in the New Salem Baptist Church in New Orleans. Mama spoke softly, her melodic voice often issuing quotations from biblical scriptures. Her religious influence was evident in each of her 16 children, 9 daughters, and 7 sons. Mama's gospel sermons of fire and brimstone held my attention for hours. I enjoyed sitting on the porch with her, drinking ice-cold lemonade, listening to her preach. Afterward, I would bombard her with questions, but I could not fathom why the religious figures in drawings and paintings were all white, and most of them glowed. I remember trying to sneak a peek whenever I saw white men, women, or children, just to see if they really did glow. They did not. In all of the religious children's literature I was given to read, there was an obvious absence of black people. Everybody was white. Angels, Jesus, Adam, Eve, Cain, Abel, Moses, and Noah. Only the devil was red. I had asked Mama, "Where were the black people like us? Did God only make white people?" Mama always seemed to be holding back. The more I'd ask race-based questions, the more she would say, "Boy, you're tiring me out with all your questions." Though I never did get a straight answer, I still believe something was not right with all those pictures depicting white figures as divine. Decades would pass before I'd be able to uncover the answers to those questions. I relished Mama's home-cooked meals, especially her gumbo and sweet potato pie. The gumbo consisted of crabs, shrimps, oysters, clams, crawdads, chicken, mild and hot link sausages, okra, and gumbo filet. The taste was heavenly, etched forever in my taste buds. Her sweet potato pies were better than any store pies I ever tasted. There were rare times when Mama would fall silent. The mention of my grandfather inevitably stopped her. He was a huge, muscular, loving, pensive man who worked tirelessly on the railroad and held other jobs to support his large family. He died from overexhaustion. He worked himself to death. He left behind no pictures of himself. He didn't like taking them. My mother said he would fight if you tried to take a picture of him. Often my mother would tell me, "If you want to know what your grandfather looked like, just look in the mirror." Since he loved Mama as I did, there is no doubt I would have loved him too. I guess I didn't realize how much I loved Mama until my mother and I were on the Greyhound bus waving goodbye to her and our other relatives. Fear and curiosity had me wondering what was in store for us in California. I could see the sadness in Mama's expression, mirroring the tears streaming down my face. Chapter 2. South Central. My mother and I were silent throughout most of that long bus ride to Los Angeles in 1959. Neither of us talked that much anyway. It was difficult for us to express our feelings, probably one of the reasons we weren't in tune with one another. Still, our bond was evident. My mother struggled hard to clothe, feed, and provide for me. She was a fighter who had to wade through incredible obstacles to her progress. In more ways than she cared to admit, we were alike, determined, stubborn, demanding, quick-tempered, and fastidious. Besides our characteristically serious expression, each of us had a black mole on the upper left side of the nose. I adored my mother, and I regret never voicing those feelings to her. As she slept on the bus, a beam of sunlight shone through the window onto the smooth, dark brown skin of her face, and I wondered if my mother was as worried as I was about our destination. After several days, the Greyhound bus finally reached the bus terminal in downtown Los Angeles, California. The ambience was strange. It was like being on another planet. People dressed differently, talked fast, and moved fast, as did the cars and trucks. I saw a small crowd of men who seemed to mirror comedian Red Skelton's portrayal of hobos. It was the first time I had ever seen a hobo close up. This was the so-called City of Angels, where my mother hoped to achieve prosperity. If she could have foreseen the path I would follow, no doubt we would have quickly reboarded the bus to return to New Orleans. After several days and nights in a motel, my mother located an affordable, furnished place to stay. It was a white duplex apartment on 43rd and Kansas on the west side, the area called South Central, or South Los Angeles, as it was recently renamed. The apartment was positioned far in the back, behind two larger duplexes. The front door of the duplex was set up high, about 3 feet, with three rickety steps up to the door. Immediately inside was the kitchen. To the left was a small living room, where I slept on a couch that unfolded into a bed. To the right in the middle of the living room was a door leading into my mother's bedroom. Inside her room, to the left, was a tiny bathroom. The entire place was smaller than a tiny classroom, but it was home. We lived in a predominantly black area of private homes, apartments, and duplexes. As I grew older, I realized that it wasn't the typical urban ghetto. It had a deceptive look of prosperity. It was a West Side colony of poverty behind a facade of manicured lawns and clean streets of Cadillacs, Fords, and Chevys. The neighborhood was a shiny red apple rotting away at the core. I was the new 6-year-old on the block, soon to undergo the ritual that would determine my position in the pecking order. The scenario was no different than one between nations, corporate executives, siblings, animals, or anyone else vying for status. The first day, outside the duplex, I was presented with a fight-or-flight option. Monroe, a stocky black youth about my height, strolled up and asked my name. I was about to say Stan when Monroe suddenly rained a barrage of punches on my head. Caught off guard, out of panicked anger, I began to swing wildly in defense. Whether it was a lucky punch or a slip, Monroe fell to the ground. Spurred by fear and instinct, I jumped on top of Monroe and started wailing away at his head. Then, abruptly, I was snatched up by Monroe's heavyset mother, smelling of cheap wine and cursing as bad as any man. She held me by the head with one arm, vice-like, while holding in her free hand a jug of wine that was spilling all over me. Mrs. Monroe marched me down the narrow walkway to the duplex and knocked on the door. When my mother opened the door, I could see the puzzled look on her face. Rocking back and forth, Mrs. Monroe released me and began to complain loudly about how I beat up her son for nothing. The evidence against me seemed overwhelming. Monroe stood there with a bloody nose, big lip, and black eye. I wanted to believe that my mother would not take the word of this foul-mouthed woman. But when my mother flashed her trademark accusatory look, there was nothing I could say. As soon as they left and I entered the duplex, my mother was all over me with a leather strap, quicker than Monroe was with his fists. I learned two valuable lessons that day. Remain silent in the face of controversy, whether I was guilty or not, and be prepared to strike first. Later, Monroe and I would befriend one another. His family lived directly across the street from us. Whenever he showed up, I could tell that my mother disapproved of our friendship, but she never uttered a word. I preferred meeting at his family's house because it was a poor child's Disneyland. The front yard was cluttered with all kinds of junk: broken toys, tires, hubcaps, refrigerators, television sets, car engines, radios, mattresses, bicycles, and other unwanted items. There were also dogs, huge white chickens, and roosters that Monroe and I used to chase around the yard. Sometimes we positioned ourselves on top of his family's house, armed with a BB rifle, to shoot at the old TV picture tubes that exploded with a satisfying bang. Our affinity for mischief led us past other boundaries of curiosity and trouble. We had several brushes with the law for minor offenses. There was a time that Monroe and I were accused of stealing Oreo cookies out of a small sack in a liquor store. The older of two Asian-looking men claimed to have seen one of us do it, but he didn't know which one, since we looked alike. They threw both of us in the back of the store and then left. The back door was locked. I saw a window behind some stacked boxes. As I climbed on top of the boxes, I felt a sharp blow to my back, causing me to fall to the floor amidst tumbling boxes. I was then pinned to the floor on my back by the younger Asian with the butt of an axe handle across my throat. From the corner of my eye, I could see Monroe creeping away like a thief in the night, only to reappear standing between two white cops. They were beaming with exaggerated pride as if they had captured a vicious killer. The shorter, pudgy cop joked about how he should have fired a shot just to scare the hell out of the little nigger. Immediately, there was a chorus of laughter among the two cops and the Asians. After the laughter died down, the younger Asian snatched me up by the collar like a rag doll and shoved me down on a box next to Monroe. For a moment, the cops and the Asians stood in a huddle, whispering. I was scared because I had heard that white cops were notorious for cracking black skulls in the neighborhood. When the huddle broke up, the cops tried to elicit a confession from us with the good cop, bad cop routine. It pissed me off that two complete strangers would try to get me to snitch. My own mother, who was deadlier than any cop to me, wasn't able to get a word out of me. Yet these cops thought they could. Plus, every child in the neighborhood knew that cops were the enemy. When the good cop routine failed, the pudgy cop tried the bad routine on me. He threatened to bust me upside the head if I didn't tell him who ate the cookies. My silence infuriated him. He snatched me forward within inches of his face. His foul breath smelled like uncooked chitterlings, bad enough to curl my eyebrows. I held my breath for so long I thought I would pass out. The other cop snatched Monroe by the collar, then held his nightstick in a threatening gesture above Monroe's head. I believe the cop would have cracked his skull wide open had Monroe not fallen to the floor and gone into convulsions. Both cops and the Asian stood there dumbfounded, their smiles gone. I was shocked to see Monroe lying on the ground with his eyes rolling back into their sockets, saliva dribbling from the corner of his mouth. Though I didn't know what to do, I dropped to my knees and placed a hand underneath Monroe's head to prevent it from continuing to bang on the floor. After rolling Monroe over onto his back, I began to rub his chest in a child's attempt to comfort him. When his eyes closed, I thought he had died, and I began to cry. But seconds later, to my surprise and relief, Monroe regained consciousness. I struggled to help him back up onto the boxes. Meanwhile, both the cops and the Asians regained their composure. Then they huddled. Afterward, they shook hands. They tried to save face by saying they were willing to let us go. The pudgy cop asked Monroe where he and I lived. In spite of his recent seizure, Monroe answered with clarity. During the short ride home in the back of the squad car, I asked Monroe what had happened. He said he had experienced seizures since he was a baby. He was epileptic. I prayed that it would never ever happen again when I was around. As the patrol car pulled into the driveway where Monroe lived, the pudgy cop asked, "Is this where you really live, boy?" Monroe said yes, and the cop burst out in laughter at the bizarre, cluttered front yard. It was like the Munsters in Los Angeles. From the patrol car, I could see Mrs. Monroe staggering out of the house wearing a black ruffled dress, red stockings, a long red feathered boa, and a red flower in her hair. She looked like a 1920s harlot. The two cops nudged one another and again broke into hysterical laughter. The pudgy cop leaned his head out of the window and told Mrs. Monroe his distorted version of what had happened. He ended by pointing at me, then asking her if she could take the mute boy home. He thought I was mute because, other than shaking my head no, I hadn't uttered a word. Though puzzled, she agreed to take me home. She muttered a few words of profanity and ordered her son into the house. She then whirled around and gave me a hard look that clearly said I was responsible for leading her son astray. To me, Mrs. Monroe was a female version of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. When sober, she was an amiable soul who liked me and didn't curse that much. But drunk, her facial expression became a scowl, her speech foul, and to her, I was like a red cape to a bull. She actually enjoyed marching me home to tell my mother lies about my getting Monroe into trouble. As usual, I prepared myself for another biblical beating, but it was not a deterrent for me. Don't get me wrong, I didn't enjoy getting into trouble. I just found the streets to be more interesting than being at home. We couldn't afford a television, so the streets became my TV set, where I played the leading role. It felt liberating to be able to face the street adventures and to make my own decisions about what I should do. Though I loved my mother, I wouldn't listen to her. There were many things I avoided telling her for my own safety, punishment-wise. There was nothing I had witnessed or experienced that I wished to reveal to my mother. Nothing. She is not responsible for my actions, any of them. My mother exhausted every possible effort to raise me properly, but she could not stand guard over me 24/7. She was enthralled to some handed-down black rendition of a Euro-American parenting philosophy that was in total conflict with the environment I saw around me and its stringent requirements for survival. Clearly, not even my mother's intentions and religious guidance could have compelled or prayed me into conforming to society's double standards. Her cordial instructions conflicted with the colony's exploitation of the underclass. I was a member of that class. As a boy, I was incapable of articulating the contradictions I saw, or to dodge confrontations with the ominous influences outside my home. Each time I stepped out into this society, rife with poverty, filth, crime, drugs, illiteracy, and daily brutal miscarriages of justice, I inhaled its moral pollutants and so absorbed a distorted sense of self-preservation. As a child, I was duped into believing that this toxic environment was normal. I was unaware of the violence being done to my mind, but my behavior was revelatory. Lacking any real knowledge of African culture, there was a black hole in my existence. As beneficiary of more than 500 years of slavery, I was left only scattered remnants of a broken culture. Exposed to a multitude of ambiguous, mostly negative influences, I would pass through my young life with cultural neglect and a profound identity crisis. Though I knew I was black, I had no real perspective on being black. I had absorbed the common negative black stereotypes that eventually made me despise my blackness. But despite my envy of the privileges, wealth, and other comforts of life held by many white people, I never fantasized about being one of them. Without the cultural knowledge I needed to shape my identity, I was unable to give my mother the respect she deserved. Since I respected neither my mother nor myself, it was inevitable that I would grow up, as I did, to disrespect other black people. Lacking an understanding of my culture, I blindly molded an identity that was a classic product of corrupt influences and my own vivid imagination. Though I was no angel, neither was I a child demon. Life deprived me of the blood of freedom and an equal opportunity to succeed. I was guilty by reason of color, convicted and sentenced at birth. Like most of my peers, I stumbled through life diseducated, a very different quality than being merely uneducated. My options and opportunities were restricted. For me, there were no Rotary clubs, yacht clubs, explorers clubs, boys' academies, or any other privilege-bound associations. I was afforded equal opportunities on society's underbelly among street thugs, ex-cons, pimps, gamblers, con men, thieves, prostitutes, and other hustler types. Here, the prevailing motifs were violence and the daily battle to survive. Might was right, always. Seen through my adolescent eyes, everything was at war. Fathers battled their wives, neighbors were at each other's throats, and criminals fought criminals. Cruelty found its home in behavior unbecoming of a human being. Sometimes at night, I would see birds on fire, soaring through the sky or crashing into a fence. I learned that gamblers were setting homing pigeons ablaze and then releasing them, wagering on which one would come closest to its destination. And we kids would imitate them. This was our culture, casually brutal and cruel in unspeakable ways. The most popular blood sport for money was dogfighting. Men would show up with different breeds of dogs in hopes of winning the cash pot. A variety of breeds were represented. Pit bulls, Great Danes, Bull Terriers, Labrador Retrievers, Chow Chows, Doberman Pinschers, St. Bernards, Bulldogs, German Shepherds, Huskies, Bull Mastiffs, and plenty of others. Back then, the gamblers would use some of us to take care of their dogs. I was paid a couple of dollars to water, feed, or patch up a mauled dog. In most of the fights, a dog would lose an eye, tail, nose, ear, and a plug of skin or part of a jaw. At first, the sight of the blood, gore, and loss of body parts was sickening, and I felt pity for the injured dogs, but I became hardened to the gruesome scenes. Whenever a particular dog was beyond patching up or was no longer wanted, one of the men would pull out his pistol and shoot the dog, or simply beat it to death with a baseball bat. Since most of the dogfights took place in abandoned houses, garages, or in pits dug out in vacant lots, the dogs were buried there, or discarded elsewhere throughout the neighborhood. These hustlers would bet on just about anything, even who could spit, urinate, or throw a rock the farthest. I have witnessed cockfights, cricket fights, fish fights, and pay-per-view street fights among individuals between 6 and 50 years of age. Older hustlers would bet on children to fight. To earn money, I would put on smelly, ragged boxing gloves and swing wildly until the other boy fell to the ground, and then I wouldn't let him up. Some of the hustlers who wanted me to win would give me pointers on how to cheat. They would advise me to hit an opponent of equal height and weight while he was taking off his jacket, tying his shoe, putting on the boxing gloves, or when he wasn't looking. But win, lose, or draw, everybody received chump change, a small amount of money. Though I won my fights, I didn't always come away unscathed. Often, my mother would catch me trying to sneak into the house with a black eye, cut lip, swollen jaw, or just blood on my shirt. As far as she was concerned, fighting was a cardinal sin. Whether I initiated the fight or someone else did, a biblical beating was on my agenda. But for me, fighting was part of growing up in South Central. My mother, bless her soul, didn't have a clue about what was happening to me, nor what I was being exposed to. Chapter 3. Sibling Feud. I had no idea a storm was brewing, one that would turn into a raging rivalry with a sibling I didn't know I had. But in 1963, my mother told me Mama would be arriving, accompanied by my sister, Cynthia. What sister? I couldn't remember my mother ever being pregnant. How could I have a sister? Then again, no one ever explained to me the fundamentals of childbirth, so I probably thought, at the time, that my mother's pregnancy was her normal shape. Seeing Cynthia for the first time was, for me, a traumatic experience. I racked my brain trying to figure out what was really going on. Yes, Cynthia was supposed to be my sister, but were we truly related? She resembled absolutely no one I knew, not my mother, mama, aunties, uncles, or me. Cynthia was a dainty and extremely light-skinned girl with shoulder-length hair and a quality of vulnerable shyness. But the moment we acknowledged one another's presence, it was pure hatred. I would come to call her cow, which earned me plenty of biblical beatings. During the few days Mama stayed with us, she cooked some of her famous sweet potato pies and delectable gumbo. To me, she was the best cook in the world. Her cornbread melted like butter in my mouth, and her fried chicken, catfish, potato salad, collard greens, and sweet corn were good enough to eat for breakfast. The presence of Mama had a tranquilizing effect on me. I tried to convince Mama to stay longer, but she had to get back to New Orleans. When it was time for her to leave, we hugged while she whispered in my ear, "Tookie, be nice, you hear? Be nice." That was the first inkling I had that she knew of my antipathy for my sister. It didn't take long for my mother and Cynthia to bond like two peas in a pod. My mother's preferential treatment of Cynthia allowed my sister to manipulate the situation to her advantage. It was obvious from Jump Street that our sister-brother relationship had deteriorated before it got started. For us, it was blow by blow, pain for pain, and verbal abuse for verbal abuse. Our aversion for one another was defined by our actions and in the usage of the word mother. Cynthia or I would emphasize personal ownership by saying, "My mother said for you too." We acted like our mother belonged to only one of us, but never both. I knew the struggle for my mother's attention was a lost cause for me. It was out of spite that I fought for the sake of fighting. Many of my biblical beatings were due to my attempts to keep Cynthia out of my space and from getting on my nerves. One day I was sitting on the couch trying to heal after a beating for going outside when I wasn't supposed to. From the couch, I could see Cynthia in the single bedroom she shared with our mother, giggling, jumping around, and pointing at me. Angered, I wanted to throw something at her that wouldn't break. I reached underneath the couch pillow to retrieve my hidden yellow dart. I focused, aimed, and threw the dart with the accuracy of a sharpshooter and hit her right between the eyes. She screamed so loud that I knew there would be hell to pay. But that beating wasn't too bad, knowing Cynthia was in pain too. Neither Cynthia nor I could fathom the importance of a real brother and sister relationship. We fought like cats and dogs. She had everybody but me fooled with her sweet little girl act. The nursery rhyme about girls being sugar and spice and everything nice was not applicable to her. She was a crafty instigator, fabricator, and manipulator. Whatever Cynthia said I had done, my mother believed. She saw me, compared to Cynthia, as aggressive, vindictive, and devious. As a member of the black male species living in a ghetto microcosm, circumstances dictated that I be either prey or predator. It didn't require deep reflection to determine which of the two I preferred. As predator, Cynthia was my prey. I was a quick study armed with contaminated knowledge, and Cynthia didn't stand a chance. She was more devious at buttering up our mother and therefore to cause trouble for me. But to avoid corporal punishment, I learned to finesse and outfox Cynthia. At home, Cynthia held a superior position. She served as our mother's third eye and ear. She would spy on me like the Central Intelligence Agency and then report back to our mother when she returned home from work. On rare occasions, Cynthia could be bribed with nickels to keep her mouth shut. I led her to believe that a nickel was worth more than a dime because the nickel was bigger. I used to charm her with a few magic tricks, making black cough drops appear out of my ear, or with a matchbox trick where a coin disappears into the matchbox. She enjoyed eating the cough drops, which helped to silence her. I guess magic appealed to Cynthia. She also believed in the Tooth Fairy, Santa Claus, and the Easter Bunny. We never had any affectionate sibling moments. Perhaps neither of us had any to give. We were as unlike as night and day. Our differences were sealed forever when I saw her naked for the first time. As a young boy, I had not yet grasped the biological distinctions between males and females. I was shocked to learn that Cynthia did not possess the male organ. I was tempted to question my mother about these issues, but such discussions were taboo for us. I just chalked it up as more of Cynthia's weirdness. I noticed that sibling rivalries in the households of friends were a bit adversarial occasionally, but tame in comparison to our feud. Though I hated her deeply, I discovered that there was a limit to my expressions of malice. Where we lived, on the other side of the fence, there was a construction site and a huge dirt lot with deep trenches, a place where neighborhood children often played. On any given day, children would have rock fights, play marbles, wrestle, or play war games with BB guns or wooden swords. Here and there lay piles of lumber, pipes, wires, nails, large buckets, and heavy machinery. Some of the trenches were too wide to cross. Over one such trench, I constructed a makeshift bridge out of several long wooden planks and booby-trapped the bridge to collapse, so a person would fall into the six-foot-deep trench. Below, I placed numerous heavy planks with long, thick, spiked nails pointed upward. This bridge of doom was a payback for whomever I despised. Along came Cynthia. One day, I spotted her skipping her merry way through the lot. Like a trapdoor spider, I was hidden behind a high mound of dirt. The moment she stepped down onto the boards, I was ready to snatch the rope and send her tumbling down onto the bed of nails. Cynthia was halfway across, and I was about to yank the rope, but something stopped me. It was neither fear nor concern about a potential beating that stopped me. I just couldn't do it to her. Perhaps it was a moment of conscience, though later in my young life I would readily snatch that same rope to harm would-be enemies. But as much as I despised Cynthia, the booby trap was something I could not execute. Yet, our feud continued well into our teenage years. Chapter 4. Hallelujah, Hallelujah. Long before I enrolled in school, I was familiar with the holy ambience of the Baptist church. It was a place where broken souls were mended, sins were forgiven, troubled minds were calmed, and incorrigible children were corrected. Back then, my mother may have thought I was a little antichrist. She recognized my shortcomings and tried everything to rectify them, but nothing worked. I could still picture myself sitting in an old wooden church pew, most of the time unreceptive and steaming with anger at being forced to be there. Occasionally, though, this house of worship was a place of wonder and excitement. I was mesmerized by the melodic voices of the choir and the rhythmic beat of the piano. When people were enraptured by the music, they would rock from side to side, clap and stomp their feet, scream, holler, or jump up and do a holy dance. The sweltering atmosphere was so charged with spiritual ecstasy that the ushers were kept busy trying to revive fainting women. There were no air conditioners, so people were sweating like melting ice cream. Most of them held paper fans with pictures of a white Jesus, and they pumped their fans like pistons to generate a little bit of cool air. Many of the women who fainted or were inspired to glossolalia, speaking in tongues, were seated next to us. Once a woman lightly patted my arm, said, "The Lord is with you," and then jumped up and down, speaking in tongues. I was scared to death. I thought the woman was going crazy. I turned to my mother for support, but she was chanting, "Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah." I sat there rigid as a statue, hoping the woman wouldn't go off on me. It was always women who seemed to be spiritually touched by God. I prayed, crossed my fingers and toes, and hoped that neither my mother nor Cynthia would faint or speak in tongues. I would have run out of church in a flash. The church barbecues, Easter egg hunts, and Christmas candies given to us made it worth my showing up. During the barbecue, everyone took a paper plate overflowing with barbecued ribs, chicken, hot links, potato salad, and corn on the cob. These were the moments I really enjoyed. However, it seemed that all other activities were adult in nature and too serious. I wondered why I sat watching a preacher point his sanctimonious finger at everybody while spitting out his fiery sermon, looking down on his parishioners from his pulpit high above the congregation. Another time, we visited a different church for my baptism. I had to wear an ankle-length white gown, underwear, no shoes, and stand in a long line with other children and adults. My question to my mother was, "Why am I here?" Her menacing look and her lightning-quick backhand that I couldn't dodge convinced me to shut up. Inside this gigantic church was a well-lit square structure for baptizing that seemed to me to be a large glass swimming pool with steps on both sides. Thus, the audience had a clear view of the baptism. In the pool were a preacher and several ushers, all dressed in white gowns, waiting for people to walk down single file into the pool. I watched as each person, one by one, was held underwater for a few seconds by two ushers. The preacher would mumble a few words, and then the person was raised out of the water, beaming. When I stepped down into the ice-cold pool, it came up to my chest. I stood there, frozen. The ushers had to guide me to the preacher. After he recited a prayer, the ushers dunked me backward into the water so quickly that I must have swallowed 3 pints of chlorinated water. I didn't even get a chance to hold my breath. I struggled desperately to free myself, but the ushers kept me under. I was waving my arms and kicking my legs like a drowning victim. When they let me up, I emerged gasping for air, choking, coughing, and spitting up water. Then and there I swore that my mother would have to straight out kill me before I let someone baptize me again. It wasn't all bad, traveling with my mother from church to church singing gospel songs. In our family, all 3 of us had the ability to sing with fine-tuned, high-pitched voices. People enjoyed hearing me or my mother sing a solo. When I sang, "How Great Thou Art," the elderly folks clapped and shouted "Amen" and "Hallelujah." Mostly, I enjoyed singing because I believe it made my mother proud of me. I overheard her telling someone that I possessed a beautiful, angelic voice. There was always debate about whether my vocal range was first or second soprano. It didn't matter because my mother loved it, and I enjoyed singing more than sitting around in the pew listening to the preacher. It was in church where I first became interested in girls, after a couple of them showed an interest in my singing. Valerie and Sheila lived a few houses down from our house. Sometimes I would sit with them on their porch, crooning out a couple of songs, gospel or soul, that earned kisses afterward. Soon the word was out that I could sing, and other girls on the block began expressing interest in my singing. It didn't fare too well with the envious young males on the block, but the abundance of kisses were a highlight that made me feel tingly and warm all over. Away from the adults, I managed to do a lot of kissing at church. I was surprised to learn that some of these girls knew hiding places where we could kiss and explore each other's bodies. In church, I was always getting into something. Though I'm not proud of it, I would show up at church, stay for the offering, duck out, and then return before the service ended. When the usher passed around the offering basket, I'd drop a few coins into it and palm $2 or $3, sometimes with Cynthia or our mother sitting beside me. As a child of poverty, I justified my theft as a need far greater than that of the other people in church. I knew the difference between the haves and have-nots. The preacher, his family, and cohorts were living high on the hog. They had fine homes, fancy clothes, and jewelry, and the preacher sported a brand new Cadillac each year. Our family was broke, no car, no bicycle, no TV, and limited clothing. I figured the few dollars I pocketed wouldn't be missed. Hamburgers cost 25 cents, French fries 20 cents, sodas 15 cents, and candy bars were 5 or 10 cents. Each Sunday that I attended church, my stomach stayed full. Clearly, my baptism was no more effective than being dunked in a local swimming pool by some homeboys, but my tenacious mother refused to give up on saving me. One sunny morning, we rode a bus to a religious revival at, I believe, the Shrine Auditorium. The building was spacious, huge, with numerous seats and a balcony. There were hundreds, perhaps thousands of people from different ethnic backgrounds packed inside the auditorium. We managed to find seats in the upper balcony. Everybody was there to see Catherine Coleman, the female preacher and revivalist heralded as a miracle worker. She was rumored to heal the sick, restore troubled lives, and perform other miracles. Her mantra, "I believe in miracles," was well known. I dozed off and missed most of the service, and then was abruptly awakened. My mother stared at me and said, "Tookie, go down to the stage and get some help." I begrudgingly got up and headed down toward the packed stage. The line was long. Standing under the bright lights, Catherine looked pale, white, and quite frail. There seemed nothing extraordinary about her, but when she touched a man, woman, or child on the forehead, that person appeared to faint and fall backward into the arms of waiting ushers. I could feel my mother's eyes penetrating the back of my skull. Failure here was not an option. I could only hope that whatever happened to those people would happen to me. My necktie felt like a hangman's noose. I was sweating profusely. When Catherine placed her hands on my forehead, I felt absolutely nothing. I was tempted to fake a fainting spell, knowing my mother was eyeing me like a hawk. Catherine removed her hand and mouthed the words, "Bless you, child." Nervously, I searched her eyes for some plausible explanation to take back to my mother, but Catherine had nothing more to say. There would be no miracles for me. Walking back to the balcony was like a death march. When I reached my mother and Cynthia, they were ready to leave. I could see my mother's expression of disappointment, shame, and God knows what else. Chapter 5. The Art of Diseducation. The time had come for me to enter a place of higher learning, but South Central's educational system was cloning and graduating students who could barely read, write, or reason. It really didn't matter which elementary school I was enrolled in because I was destined to be diseducated. I've coined the term diseducation to depict the abnormal, impaired, and diseased knowledge I received in life and from the public school system. The first school my mother enrolled me in was Menlo Avenue Elementary School, several blocks from where I lived. I braved the surroundings with a great deal of curiosity and eagerness to learn. My willingness to learn was somewhat hampered by Miss Atkins, the teacher assigned to the classroom. She and I would bump heads while I was there. Miss Atkins was a rosy-cheeked, short, stout Caucasian woman with her hair fashioned in a bun on the back of her head. She wore horn-rimmed glasses with a shiny silver chain hanging slightly in front, circling her head. She felt it was her duty to punish children in her classroom. The most popular method of punishment at that time was called the ferule discipline. A wooden ruler was used to repeatedly beat the inside of a child's hand. The child was told to stand before the entire class with palms up and endure the pain without moving. If the child moved, the discipline would start over. Just about every day I witnessed children squirming in pain as tears rolled down their cheeks. Just watching the ruler whacking a classmate's palm made me wince. Though I cannot remember a boy or girl crying out, not one of them refused to accept the punishment. When it was time to be punished, each one walked mechanically to the front of the class and assumed the position. A biblical beating from my mother was one thing, but a school beating I refused to accept. I would run if I had to. It was inevitable I'd be called to stand before the class to be thoroughly disciplined. One day, a classmate asked if he could borrow some paper, and I said yes. Miss Atkins saw me passing the paper and assumed I was playing around. Her voice resonated like a megaphone when she yelled, "Stanley Williams, report to the front of the class." The room fell silent. I could hear my classmates breathing. I refused with a single firm no. Someone in the classroom gasped so loud I had to look around. Miss Atkins's face turned beet red in disbelief and anger. Behind her desk, she used a more authoritative tone. "Stan, I want you up here in front of this class right now." Again, I refused. My refusal was a stinging blow to her frail ego. I had defied her system of voluntary discipline. Visibly shaking, she pointed a stubby finger and ordered me to report to the principal's office. I got up slowly and swaggered to the office. The principal, a tall, slender man, was pleasant enough, but his lecture was about 1 hour long. I sat there listening without saying a word. The principal decided not to call my mother and told me to return to class. After that clash with Miss Atkins, my classmates seemed to warm up to me. I began to make friends and was no longer just a new arrival. I was the hero who had challenged the dragon lady. From that day forward, she never attempted to discipline me, but we did butt heads over other issues. In her class, reading and writing seemed to be prohibited, but we were provided with mounds of clay, paper mache, puzzles, and all kinds of non-educational items. Pencils and erasers were nowhere to be found. There were shelves of books that students did not read. They seemed to be there just to decorate the classroom. I got on Miss Atkins's nerves, bothering her each day about letting me read a book. The more she refused, the more determined I was to read the literature on those shelves. I was a darn good reader for my age. At home, there was a box filled with books. Sometimes I would dump the books on the floor and sit in the middle of the pile trying to read everything. Often, my mother would help me with the spelling and pronunciation of words. One of my favorite books was an encyclopedia on dogs with numerous color photos. I could read for hours about different breeds of dogs. Reading was a pastime I truly enjoyed and a way of escaping from my often riotous thoughts. In my reading world, there was no poverty, no discrimination, no violence, no racism, no pain, and no Cynthia. Thievery became necessary to allow me to pilfer a book off the school library shelf and avoid being busted by Miss Atkins. My partner in crime was Sheila, a chubby black girl with a short, curly natural, large brown eyes, dimples, and a contagious smile. Together, we pretended to be working on a project while taking turns reading from a book held in our laps. The first time Miss Atkins caught us reading, she thought there must be some hanky-panky going on. When we were made to stand up, the two books fell off our laps onto the floor. Miss Atkins had a fit, storming out of the classroom, shouting, "I'm calling your mother! I'm calling your mother!" This phoning your mother was a scenario that was played out with me 3 or 4 times a week, twice a day. If Miss Atkins had her way, instead of calling my mother, I'd have been handcuffed by police and escorted to jail. Perhaps because she sensed my potential, she was driven to hinder or obliterate my intentions. To all who would listen to her outbursts, Miss Atkins would paint a false portrait of me, assassinating my character, behavior, mental state, and ability to learn. Perplexed, I watched in horror as she performed a masterful act of fake humility and concern for me in the presence of my mother. To parents, she was the epitome of what all teachers should be, but I had her number. I knew she was wicked. All I wanted to do was become educated, not to battle with a deranged teacher over my constitutional right to read school books. The odds were stacked against me. Miss Atkins's authority made her my nemesis. She had the principal, teachers, parents, my mother, and even the janitor in her corner. Who would believe me? Whom could I talk to? The more my mother came up to the school to chastise me, the more it strengthened Miss Atkins's assertion that I was a very disruptive child. Whether Miss Atkins busted me, Sheila, or other classmates who joined us in a clandestine study program, she would call only my mother. For every minute my mother spent away from work addressing this conflict, money was deducted from her paycheck. Perhaps the teacher was aware of that, but she viewed me as just another little darky whom she openly predicted would fail in life. In her warnings to other students about examples of bad behavior, she pointed a finger at me. "Look at Stanley. He is not what you want to be." If ever a teacher needed psychological testing to be allowed to teach children, she was a prime candidate. It was a surprise several months later when Miss Atkins implemented a reading and writing period in her class, but we were still largely on our own. As usual, she sat behind her desk crocheting, head tilted down, looking over her glasses at us, mostly at me. She seemed to enjoy humming the hymn, "Shall We Gather at the River, the beautiful river." It was odd that such an oppressive person would enjoy singing a church song. Fortunately, before she was able to have me expelled, I was transferred to another school. Although there were no farewells, I knew I would miss Sheila. Now I was able to breathe a breath of fresh air. Cynthia and I were enrolled in Normandy Avenue Elementary School in the adjacent daycare center. Each school day after kissing our mother on the cheek, we headed toward the daycare center, where Cynthia and I stayed before and after school until 4 p.m. The breakfasts and lunches tasted much better than the school's cafeteria food. All in all, daycare was a nice, clean place to be, with a lot of activities for children. There were two memorable figures who worked at the center, Mrs. Blue and Miss Davis. Both of these black women were exceptionally kind to all the children. It was Miss Davis who comforted me when I had a run-in with the door and with the monkey bars. She accompanied me to a nearby clinic where I was patched up. In her early 20s, Miss Davis was tall, slender, cinnamon-colored, with a curly, brownish-gold afro. She would drive up in a small black convertible sports car, usually wearing brightly colored tennis attire and with a tennis bag over her shoulder. Her tennis dress was skimpier than a miniskirt, but I wasn't complaining. Watching her practice hitting tennis balls off the wall raised my interest in female anatomy to a new level. Whether retrieving balls or sitting on a milk crate, I admired her sleek movement as her skirt hiked up to unbelievable heights. She had a preachy saying, "We sisters are black queens, and we have to keep our bodies firm and beautiful." Amen to that. In total contrast, Mrs. Blue was in her late 40s, perhaps early 50s. She was short, with smooth brown skin and bluish permed hair. Mrs. Blue was sweet as pie and loved reading stories to us. When I did get into trouble, she tried to rescue me from the school's impulse to expel me. Mrs. Blue would rather control me than threaten punishment. In a way, her religious quotes and sermons were similar to my grandmother's, but she always found something good to say about me. I remember sitting between Mrs. Blue and my mother as Mrs. Blue bragged about how smart I was. Her words were like sweet droplets of honey poured down my throat. Encouragement was an element I didn't receive enough of in my life. In school, I maintained between a B+ and an A average. My ability to read, write, and retain knowledge was evident with each passing year. So far, my efforts and behavior were an A+. I occasionally got into a few scrimmages, but what black man child didn't rumble and tumble as a youngster? It was rare for me to fight a girl, but this girl named Janice was no ordinary female. I was about 4'6", and Janice stood about 6 feet tall. She was broad at the shoulders, with a hairstyle like buckwheat on the little rascals, and a mean expression. I was told she liked me, but she had a strange way of showing it. In class, she would throw books at me when I wasn't looking, or place a thumbtack on my chair. One day, I placed several thumbtacks on her chair. She sat down and jumped up screaming like a banshee. She stood there looking around at the entire class and screamed, "Who did that?" The frightened classroom didn't have to say my name. I was busted the moment they all turned to look at me. That's when Janice threatened to beat me up after school. She wasn't fooling around. I had seen her beat a guy to a bloody pulp in the school bathroom. Janice could fight like a dude. She was tough, probably too tough for me to handle. Seated several rows away, she stared at me while pounding her fist in the palm of her hand. Then, from left to right, she slowly drew her finger across her throat, indicating my doom. She was dead serious about hurting me, and I didn't doubt it. The general rule in the culture was never to strike a female under any circumstances, but Janice was no ordinary girl. She could fight. At that moment, she frightened me so much that my mouth became dry and my heart jumped up in my throat. To further intimidate me, Janice started acting as if she was about to rush over and attack me. Since I wasn't packing my trusty butter knife or a set of brass knuckles, I was a nervous mess. When I looked up at the clock, it was 2:45 p.m. School was about to end and Janice had dozed off. It was now or never. I eased out of my chair and circled around behind where she sat. Unmanly or not, I was on Janice like a wild man, knocking her and the chair to the floor. Fearful she would get back up, I was about to crown her with a chair when the teacher caught hold of it in midair. To the amazement of the class, and me as well, Janice stayed on the floor crying. For the first time, I saw her as a girl, not as a bully or a beast. She was human after all. Though I felt a sense of remorse, I knew the fight was far from over. Janice had two brothers at the school, Vincent and an older brother, Arthur. I later learned that the two brothers agreed that Vincent would restore their sister's honor. Being bigger and taller, he bragged to classmates about what he was going to do. It was on the daycare's playground where I ran into Vincent and his stocky friend, Frank. When he gestured for me to come where they were standing, it meant only one thing. I was taking a risk because no one was around to intercede if they both attacked me, or if I was on the losing end. As I approached, Vincent started taking off his sweater. When his face was completely covered, his arms held high in the air underneath the sweater, I attacked. As I rushed forward, Frank stepped aside as if he were a matador dealing with a charging bull. I threw a lot of haymakers that drove Vincent up against the fence. Out of nowhere, Miss Davis appeared and held me in a bear hug from behind. Afterward, Vincent pulled down his sweater, picked up his glasses, and walked away, trailed by Frank. Miss Davis and I went inside where she wiped my face with a wet towel. She asked why I was fighting such a big boy. I told her we were just playing around. She smiled and said, Maybe you were playing, but he sure wasn't. Escaping adult eyes was the backdrop of a training ground for fighting in and away from school. In street fights, fairness was an abstraction of moronic dimensions. It could get you killed. I learned from others to fight dirty, to cheat, and to look for angles, openings, mistakes. The prime rule of fighting was this: there were no rules.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.